Are you looking for a crash course in cinematography? You are in luck. Here are 13 moments where cinematography took it to the next level in 2020.
Mank. Mr. Mank was...
Shot in a digital format, Eric Messerschmidt made modifications to give Mank an authentic look, including which lenses to use, which filters, and many other decisions.
I support that.
In the flashback scenes from the 30s, the lighting techniques were different from the scenes that took place in the 40s, using harsher shadows and slivers of light, while other scenes use a more modern look.
Jesus, what is that?
Sunlight. It's nearly noon.
Then, there was the dinner confrontation near the end of the film.
Hello, everyone.
As a very complex shot, this required extensive blocking for both the camera crew, as well as where Gary Oldman would stand, as well as when to say specific lines.
Love him enough to make him president, but they won't.
It took 100 takes. While Messerschmidt certainly knows how to create a look and tone from another era,
Pops likes you.
Wait until you see what the Five Bloods' Newton Thomas Siegel has in store.
Now I know why this mission was so damn important.
First, there were flashback Vietnam scenes. Needing to create moments that were gritty and haunting, yet distorted through retrospect, Siegel moved away from the digital camera used to shoot most of the film and shot these scenes in 16mm. This provided a strikingly different look from the rest of the Five Bloods. While the entire film is rich in vibrant color, the color in these flashback scenes are less contained and practically bleed, giving these flashbacks the look of a graphic war movie from years back. This was accentuated even further using a 4:3 aspect ratio that isn't only fitting for the time, but provided a subtle hint that, unlike the present day, maybe we weren't seeing the whole picture.
Hold on!
A terrific use of natural lighting was also implemented, much like in this scene where Paul, haunted by years of guilt and PTSD, is seemingly able to make amends with not just Storm and Norman, but himself.
Ain't no thing.
Spike himself referred to this as God's natural light. Then, there's Paul's iconic soliloquy, which is a shot you could write an entire essay about.
You got the guts, Paul got.
They ain't their fault. They're born weak.
While this is similar to Spike Lee's trademark forward-facing double dolly, the camera work here isn't quite as fluid or surreal. Handheld and jerky, some moments feel chaotic, while others are still and tranquil, as if Paul is having a moment of clarity.
Not Paul. No, sir. I ain't getting fucked again.
Overall, this is a beautifully raw and honest scene that demonstrates excellent chemistry between an actor and a camera.
Not this time.
Now, let's see how the Midnight Sky's Martin Rue captures the harshness of two places known for being unforgiving and cold. Shot on an actual glacier in Vatnajökull, Iceland, the harsh elements required meticulous planning and a go-with-the-flow approach to filming.
You'll be fine.
One shot that came out of this was this suspenseful encounter with a pack of wolves.
I see you!
Blinded by heavy amounts of snow, our imaginations are forced to run wild with just how big the pack may be. Then there's this shot which captures the visceral action as Augustine and Iris try to escape the cracking ice. Through the use of handheld shots that tilt and pan at just the right time, as well as a few underwater shots, we're shown just how unforgiving this environment can truly be. Rue was able to create a sense of chaos in two locations.
Yes, sir.
Now, let's see how the trial of the Chicago Seven's Faden Papamichael captures two chaotic tones in the same city.
Lock up the long hair!
To help create a sense of passion and energy, the protest scenes were mostly close up and only required 200 extras, as opposed to the thousands of people that actually protested in 1968.
We're going to the convention! Let's get on the street! Get on the street!
That said, getting these shots was still rather complicated and depended on frequent communication between Papamichael and his crew, often having to rely on pure luck and happy accidents. Directly juxtaposing these chaotic moments is the mostly fluid and choreographed cinematography inside the courtroom. While the color choices were warm yet faded in other shots, the courtroom is bleaker and given a harsher overcast lighting. There's still a sense of chaos, but it's more subdued.
I think Tom Hayden is a badass of an American patriot.
One shot that really gets this across is in the beginning as we travel around the courtroom to see several contrasting conversations and actions taking place. However, those same people show a newfound solidarity at the very end.
Thomas Anthony Scabelli, 26 years old.
Papa Michael brought a true story to life through the power of cinema. Now let's see how Matthew Libatique was able to do the same thing with Broadway.
Talk to the folks in the biz.
Libatique manages to find a sweet spot between theater and cinema in this number, which takes place at a mall. The screen is filled with pops of color, saturation and lighting that create the larger-than-life tone of a stage show, with spacious wide shots and framing that alludes to a Broadway stage. He also uses frequent traveling camera shots to break up the wide shots, yet maintain the energy the scene requires. While musicals are mostly known for their showstoppers and fight songs, there are also smaller, more vulnerable moments that are just as important to capture.
Can I make an observation?
Is it a pleasant observation or is it an irritating one?
One scene worth mentioning is when Barry and Dee Dee confide in each other in their hotel room.
He took my little delicate blueberry heart and he just squished it.
Giving this scene a toned-down look with earthy tones, natural shadows, and handheld camera work, Libatique gives these characters a chance to tear down the walls and be truly relatable.
No. They threw me away.
Well, did they really?
I told them that I was gay, and they said that they would take me to therapy to change myself completely.
Libatique was able to adapt the spectacle and drama of musical theater. Now, let's see how Tobias A. Schleisler did it with another stage adaptation, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom.
I wanna learn that thing.
What's the matter, Ma?
Where's my Coke? I need a cold Coca-Cola.
Schleisler delivers beautiful shots that pop in vibrant color and have a sense of heat, passion, and intensity that perfectly capture the Chicago elements. One in particular worth mentioning,
get the boy's money!
Okay.
Is right after Ma Rainey demands money from the record executive. While the entire scene embodies this intensity, there's this one silent moment where just Ma sits in the chair and stews in her own thoughts. It's only for a few seconds, but it feels like an eternity. Though the camera pulls in, it seems to be cautious.
Levy got to be Levy!
Another scene that stands out during a passionate monologue, brilliantly performed by Chadwick Boseman. We are taken on an emotional roller coaster told almost entirely through the late actor's face. The camera shows us every wince, tremor, and crinkle that make up this heartbreaking story and why the character is the way he is. If that weren't enough, at the point when Levy pulls open his shirt to reveal his scar,
that's what made them stop.
The camera stays on his face.
It was scared I was gonna bleed to death.
Sure, we see a little bit of it, but Schleisler knew that the emotional scars told through Chadwick's face are the sight to behold. Who's your favorite next level cinematographer? Who else takes it to the next level? Let us know in the comments.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.